Welcome to New Hope Community Church on the first Sunday of March. If you're standing, they're bringing a few chairs in and sitting. Well, probably if you just go from the middle back, that'll be good. Yeah, I think so. Looks like most of them have got a spot. But welcome today. If you are visiting with us at New Hope, thank you for being here. If you're visiting because somebody is being baptized that you know, thank you for making it very special for them by your presence. If you're visiting just because you're coming to New Hope for the very first time, there are visitor cards in the pew. We would love for you to take one out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by, and next week through the mail, we will send you information about New Hope Church. We promise we will not beat on your door, bother you on the phone, but through the mail, send you information that we hope will be very, very helpful for you. What I'd like to do first thing, and this will make a little bit more room on a couple of the pews, is I'm going to invite our baptism candidates to come and have a seat on the front row. You are our honored guest, and I'm going to call you by name, all right? When I call you by name, I want you to get up and come and have a seat right here on the first row. Brody Fish. Brody, would you come on down? Brody. I am so excited to baptize Brody today. Give me five, buddy. All right, just have a seat right there, Brody, okay? Amy Wicks, are you? Come on up, Amy. We're excited, Amy. Come on down. Have a seat right up here. Ed and Kelly Dunkel. All right, Ed and Kelly, husband and wife. We're really excited about them. All right, great. Ed, thank you. Kelly, that's all right. Terrific. Jim Critchfield. Jim, come on down. All right. Woo. Attaboy, buddy. Woo. I might hold you under just a little longer than everybody else. Marilyn Choate, come on up. Marilyn, come on up, please. Have a seat. Brooke Gerald, come on down, Brooke. All right. Just have a seat right up here. Dane Pittman. Dane, come on forward. I had the privilege of marrying this guy. Now I get to baptize him. Attaboy, Dane. Thank you for the privilege. All right. All right, and I think that wraps up our night. Did I miss anybody for our 9:15 service? Anybody that I didn't call your name? Make sure we didn't get messed up on time. All right, terrific. And you guys just sit here till we give you directions to go out, all right? Just enjoy it. You are a special honored guest today. Let me highlight a few announcements and then a couple of prayer requests, and we'll get engaged as directly as we can in our worship today. Today, after our third service, this is our homeless outreach day. If you have never been on one of our homeless outreach, you're invited to come and join us right after the 10:45 service. So at about 12:15, if you would just meet over in the Murbach building, that's the building in front of the children's playground. Just show up there and they'll tell you what to do. You don't need any previous experience, all right? Just show up and they're going to bag some lunches and prepare some other things for giveaways as they head out today. They usually finally leave here about 1 o'clock and return between 2:30 and 3. So if you've never done it before and you have other plans today, just know it's the first Sunday of every month, okay? The first Sunday of every month is our homeless outreach. Coming up this Friday night and Saturday is our Sweetheart Conference. This is a conference on marriage. Whether you have been married 6 months or 60 years, we would love to have you at this marriage conference, all right? This is whether your marriage is sizzling or stuck, all right? Or anywhere in between. This is just a great pick-me-up, all right, for marriage to illustrate the value that God puts on marriage and to see what His directions are. Joe Grizzle is coming out from Norman, Oklahoma to share. He's been doing this for over 35 years. He's been married for 48 years. Joe is an outstanding communicator. You're going to enjoy him immensely. Dinner will be from 6 to 7 on Friday night. You get dinner with us, all right? 6 to 7 on Friday night. Conference will begin in here from 7. It'll go 7 to 9. And then Saturday morning, men's second Saturday breakfast has been canceled this month. And so we will start at 9:30 and end at 12:30, all right, on Saturday morning. Child care is being provided. If you've already signed up and haven't paid, just put your money in an envelope, $25, write on it with your name, Sweetheart, and we'll see that it gets applied there. If you signed up and you are not attending, please let the office know because food will be prepared. We have 67 couples, I believe, signed up right now. That is awesome, guys. 60. You get a chance to get acquainted with other folks as well, plus just have a grand time. And then Joe will be with us in next Sunday morning service as well, and you will enjoy him immensely. Celebrate Recovery, a week from this coming Thursday. Not this Thursday, but the following Thursday is the fifth anniversary of Celebrate Recovery here at the church. If you have appreciated and enjoyed their ministry here, show up for a Thursday night celebration. They're going to have a barbecue out on the grounds. If it's not raining, and if it is, we'll move something indoors, all right? And then there'll be a worship time here in the sanctuary, so come and join them for that special celebration. On Sunday night, March the 16th, Lindsay Eccles, Katie Kolb, and myself will take about an hour from 6 to 7, 7:15, and we will share pictures and slides and stories of our trip to Africa, all right, the first 2 weeks of February. So if you're interested in that, come and join us that evening. And we're going to make that just a potluck dessert, all right? Whatever you bring that doesn't have many calories in it, we'll share it all together afterwards and go home not getting fat over it, all right? I'm dieting in case y'all can't tell right now, all right? So low-cal stuff. Hey, biggest event, usually most exciting event of the year, the last Sunday of this month. It's a five-Sunday month, so this is March the 30th. We have our annual fundraiser for our Mexico mission trip, our annual pie auction. This is where we auction off pies, desserts, main dishes, anything that you can make homemade. Bring it, make it look pretty, and we will spend an hour and a half. I got 10, who's going to give me 20, 20, who'll give me 30? I got 30, who's going to give me 35, 35, looking for 45. And we do that for an hour and a half almost nonstop. And we raise anywhere from $10,000 to $17,000 for our Mexico mission trip. It's our high school kids where they go down and make a difference in a small community in Mexico. It's a construction project. It's vacation Bible school. It's a cross-cultural experience. I think we have about 40, I've been told, that are going this year. So come and join us. Put it on your schedule. Usually it starts at 6, and we're out of here by about 7:30, quarter to 8. So come for part or all of that. If you've never been, you owe it to yourself to come. It is quite an experience. Son of God is being shown in the theaters right now. It started on Friday. If you are a moviegoer, go support one of these faith-based movies that's out. There's going to be three over the next 6 weeks. This one just started. Noah is coming out in March, and God Is Not Dead is coming out, I believe, the first part of April. So Tuesday at Sierra Vista Mall is $5 Tuesday. All day long, including evening, you can go to the movies for $5. Our small group is going on Tuesday evening. If you would like to join us, we're going to the one closest to about 7 o'clock. And I don't know what one that is yet, but show up. It's at 7 o'clock. If you want to come and make our small group a big group, come and join us. But it's Dutch. Our group's not paying for your group, all right? So but go see it. I think it's going to be really, really good. Let me highlight, notice the thank yous in here. Last Sunday night, the church made the decision of what to missions organizations we would send our last Sunday of 2013 offering to. We divided $10,000 between two, and one of them was 1040i, and then the other one was Aviation in Action from right here out of our own church. And so there are thank yous in the bulletin for both of them already, so please take note of that. A couple of prayer requests. Wanda Medeiros from our church, her mother passed away early Thursday morning. Her son took her to the hairdresser on Wednesday, dropped her off at home, said, I'll check on you a little bit later, Mom. And between that time and the time he checked on her, the neighbors saw her on the front porch, called 911, and she had, as the doctors described, a stroke within a stroke. And it was a massive brain hemorrhage. So please be praying for their family, and services are still being determined. Barbara Quintana, if you've been a long-time attender here at New Hope, you might remember Barbara. She's not been able to be with us for several years now as a result of dementia. But she's been in the hospital the latter part of this week, not expected to make it, and she might already be home with the Lord. I have not heard since early yesterday, so please remember their family. Odell Jones had surgery, and he is recovering well, and we're grateful for that. And Ricky and Cody are going to give birth Tuesday morning, and so we're very excited for them. And if you are visiting with us, what makes that? I mean, all births are very exciting, all right? There's not a baby born that we don't get excited about around here. But for Ricky and Cody, they're a young couple. We're new to our church 2.5 years ago. And in fact, I had the privilege of marrying them. And about 6 months after they were married, they were pregnant. And they had a baby that they knew early on would not live, but Ricky chose to carry it full term. Eleanor lived for about 16 hours. And granted, actually, Ricky's request that she just get to hold her baby girl. And she got to spend the night with her. And we were able to be there, Shelly and I, with him through that process. And we're so grateful. And we got an invitation. We get to be with him Tuesday morning. And their baby boy is doing well, and he's very healthy. And so we are grateful for that. So that event will take place. Yes, Milo Martin is a wonderful gentleman, longtime member at Northwest Church. He's visited here on a few occasions. Good friends with Joe and several others of us around here. So under hospice care, we'll remember him. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us this morning as we have our morning tithes and offerings. And folks, if some people get up and leave after the offertory, don't feel bad about them. They're from the 8 o'clock service, and I told them they would want to hear my twin brother sing I Can Only Imagine. This is Tim, and I'm Tim. Kind of like Daryl and my other brother Daryl. But anyway, and thanks for filling in one of the Sundays I was gone. Appreciate it a bunch. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, we love you. We're exceedingly grateful for your love for us. That love is being demonstrated visibly in front of us today as we watch these men and these women, these young boy and young ladies, step into a baptistry today, and that's an expression of their response to your great love for them. And so we say thank you for that. We say thank you for your sufficiency in our lives this week as we have trusted you with our needs and our circumstances, with our challenges and our calendars. And Father, we say thanks that you've been big enough for the task when we have been mindful enough to trust you. Father, we commit to you the needs of those who are here who have some surgery scheduled. We're grateful for those who are recovering well from surgery, for Hazel who's here today and doing good, and for Dan Boitano who's here today and doing well from his surgery. For Odell, we trust you with his recovery. For Gene and his recovery, we just continue to say thanks in these areas. Lord, for Jim Critchfield who got the news this week that he will die of something else besides this cancer. And so we say amen and we give you praise today. We thank you for the doctor and their care and the way in which they responded. And we are grateful for the way that you've engineered Jim's body and how well it responded to the treatment. And we just really say thank you for all of that. Well, we pray for Wanda and others this week who have experienced the loss of a member of their family. And we trust you for their needs of care and comfort. Lord, for the privilege of giving today, we say thank you. The opportunity to share a testimony of our confidence in you and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we offer our tithes and our offerings today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we send our candidates off for baptism, we're going to share with you just a little bit out of the Word, and with those of you who have joined them today, a little bit different order of service today. I'm also going to do something with you all that I have never done with another group of candidates for baptism ever before. I see that look of great joy and delight on your face as you hear that. You thought you knew exactly what to expect today, but it's going to be slightly different. So, but I'll tell you exactly what to do at the right moment, all right? So we just want you to relax. And guys, why don't you go sit down for a minute, all right? Because you're going to get tired standing there. We're going to sing after a short message, okay? You're saying, Tim, you never do a short message. Were you here when I came over here from the other service? 15 minutes to 9, I was over here. All right, so it will be short. But that was the 8 o'clock service. Actually, in the book of Acts, there are two chapters right next to each other, Acts chapter 8 and Acts chapter 9, and two very incredible things happen in both of those chapters, and I want to highlight those at the outset today. In Acts chapter 8, picking up at verse 34, it steps into the middle of a story where Philip is told by the Lord, hey, there's this Ethiopian eunuch. He's come to Jerusalem to find me, and he couldn't find me. And he's on his way home. Philip, I want you to run out there, and I want you to tell him about me because he's looking for me. Philip, literally, if you read the text, Philip runs Okay? And he catches up with the guy in the chariot. And the guy in the chariot is reading out of the book of Isaiah. And as Philip is jogging along, he says, "Do you understand what you read?" And the eunuch stops and says, "How can I understand what I'm reading unless somebody explains it to me?" And Philip said, "That's why I'm here." And so Philip explains to him, and that's where we're going to pick up. Notice verse 34. The eunuch asked Philip, "Tell me, please, who is the prophet they're talking about, himself or somebody else?" And then Philip began with that very passage of Scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. As they traveled along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, "Look, here's water. Why shouldn't I be baptized?" Notice, it's not Philip who says this. It is the eunuch. You see, this whole theme of baptism, it had made a really big splash in the last year or two around the countryside. Some of you got that one, right? Really big splash. Okay, good. I worked half a week on that line. But no, this is something they'd never seen before John the Baptist. And then now, after the resurrection of Jesus, man, these men and women from all over the world, they're being immersed, they're being dunked, they're being baptized because they believe in this Jesus. And the Ethiopian says, "Hey, you've told me who the prophet Isaiah was talking about. I believe in him. What is to stop me from being baptized right now?" Philip said, "Nothing." So they went down into the water and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord suddenly took Philip away. Job finished. Philip, I got something else for you to do, and it's described. But I want to jump over one chapter. Chapter 9 is the story of a guy by the name of Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus was a killer of Christians. He did it for religious reasons, but he was still a killer of Christians. And on his way to Damascus to arrest some more Christians, he was confronted with Jesus Christ. And he continues to walk blind into the city of Damascus. And an older Christian in Damascus, Ananias, is told by God, "I want you to go see Saul of Tarsus." Ananias, "God, you got a great sense of humor. I'm a Christian. He's a killer of Christians. Why would I want to go see him?" Because you see, Jesus died even for murderers. Jesus died even for the killer of Christians. And God told Ananias, "I have a great work for Saul of Tarsus to do." And so Ananias went, and that's where I want to pick up in the story, verse 17. Then Ananias went to the house and he entered it, placing his hands on Saul. He said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here has sent me so that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes. He would see again. He got up and he was baptized. Do you notice? As soon as men and women received Christ, they baptized them. Okay? They didn't have to understand everything. They just knew that the first step of obedience after becoming a Christian was to be baptized. Jesus said this in Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always, even to the very end of the age." As I read that scripture this week in anticipation of today, I was excited and I was disappointed. I was excited because for the very first time in the month of February, I had the opportunity to go to an uttermost part of the world, to another nation, and I had the opportunity one night under a tree to lead an African man to Jesus Christ. I got to carry out this part of the Great Commission on another continent. And my one regret was I didn't baptize him the next morning. I thought when I read this, I thought, dang it, I should. Then I could have said, man, I've been a part of this to the uttermost parts of the world.
So when I go back next February, if he's not been baptized, we're going to baptize him next year. All right? Guaranteed. Next year, next February. Yeah. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21 says this, this water in baptism symbolizes that we have been saved. It's not the removal of dirt from the body, but it's the pledge of a clear conscience towards God. It saves us by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You all are being baptized today, not in order to get saved, but as a symbol that you have been saved. God is calling. Don't put him on hold. Okay? Little Holly had faithfully attended baptism classes. Her mother, wanting to be sure that her daughter understood the significance of baptism, asked her one afternoon, "Honey, tell Mama what baptism means." "Well, it isn't the water that makes you clean," she began. Smiling, the mother thought, "Yes, she's got it. She understands." And then her daughter added, "It's not the water, Mommy. It's the soap that gets you clean." It's not soap and it's not water baptism, but it is the shed blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses you and me from all of our sins. And as the old song says, it makes us white as snow. Several years ago, in fact, probably a couple of decades ago now, newspapers in the state of Kansas carried a story about a man by the name of Al Johnson. Al Johnson had repented of his sins and he came to faith in Jesus Christ. Now, that is not the reason they printed a story about Al Johnson in the newspaper. Quite frankly, I've been around for 59 years now and I've never yet read an article in a newspaper telling the rest of the world somebody got saved. Okay? I think it's newsworthy, but they don't usually. What made this a newsworthy story was what happened as a result of his newfound faith in Christ. Al confessed to a bank robbery he had participated in when he was 19 years old. Because the statute of limitations on that case had run out, Johnson could not be prosecuted for the offense. But because he had this complete change of heart, he not only confessed to the crime, but he voluntarily repaid his share of the stolen money back to the people it was stolen from. Folks, that is repentance. That is a radical reconstruction of the heart. And that's what you're giving testimony to today, that you've allowed Christ to come into your life and reconstruct your heart. Sometimes, us pastors can be susceptible to doing some kind of silly things. Not intentionally, usually. It's often by accident. So it's no surprise that there's a story told about a kind of a goof at a baptism. And I think this is an appropriate month to tell the story. Because the one who did this big goof on this one baptism was St. Patrick. This is St. Patty's Day month, all right? So St. Patrick was about to baptize the king. Sometime during the ritual of that baptism, St. Patrick leaned on a sharp pointed staff that was on the king's foot. And it went right through his foot. And he was bleeding. St. Patrick did not know that until he was finished with the ceremony. And he looked down and he saw the blood pooling around the king's foot and he began to apologize and to beg the king's forgiveness. "Why did you suffer in silence?" St. Patrick asked the king. And the king responded, "I thought it was part of the ritual." I promise you all, there is nothing bloody about our baptism today, all right? I do have a staff, though, in the baptistry with me today, but don't be afraid. Aaron McManus, a pastor and an author, reminds us that Christianity is a dangerous faith. It always has been. It's intended to always be. Listen to what he said. He said, "How could we ever think that the Christian faith would be safe when the central metaphor for Christianity is an instrument of death called the cross? It's not a coincidence that baptism is described as a watery grave depicting death to sin, being raised in the newness of life, a picture of the resurrection." It was Major Thomas who made it very clear one time from this podium when he said, "What is the antidote to death? Resurrection. The Bible says we were born dead in our trespasses and sins. Being placed under the water is a picture of death to sin and self. And being brought out of the water is a picture of being born again, raised from your spiritual death, just as one day you will be raised from your physical death. It's no less significant, McManus goes on to say, that the ongoing ordinance of the Lord's Supper, that which we shared in just last Sunday, is a reminder of sacrifice. How in the world did the church ever develop a safe theology from such a dangerous faith? That fits with what we've been talking about over the last several weeks, a faith that is risky, risky faith. To those of you on this front row, I hope today will be a defining moment for you. I remember the date of my baptism. I was 8 years old. I can tell you who sat on the front row. I can tell you who was in the baptistry with me. I remember like it was yesterday. I've asked that question to folks who have had believers' baptism, not infant baptism, but believers' baptism. Do you remember the day of your baptism? They may not be able to give me the date, but they can tell me exactly what happened that day. It is a defining moment, and I hope it will be for you. I want you to understand that this day has two serious implications to it. First of all, this is a day of declaration. You are making a public statement. Though you may not be using all of these words with your lips, by your actions today in baptism, you are saying this is a day of declaration, and here is what I declare. You are saying, I am a believer in Jesus Christ. I believe that He is God the Son. I believe that He came as a man and He died a death He did not deserve so I could live a life I could never earn. I have confessed my sin. I have accepted Christ's forgiveness. I declare that I am a child of God and that Jesus Christ is my Savior and my Lord. This is a day of declaration. I'm going to ask each of you to stand. You've heard what I'm asking of you today. I'm going to ask all of you to stand. I would like you to turn and face your family and friends and people you've never, ever met before. And this is going to be a little bit like a wedding ceremony. I'm going to ask you to declare your commitment today, publicly, verbally. Just as you did on a wedding day when you said your vows to a spouse, I'm going to ask that you say your vows to Christ. So I'm going to give you a sentence, and I'm going to ask all of you in unison, if you believe that sentence, to repeat it after me out loud. Are you ready? All right. I am a believer in Jesus Christ. I believe He is God the Son. He came as a man and died a death He did not deserve so I could live a life I could never earn. I have confessed my sin and accepted His forgiveness. I declare that I am a child of God and that Jesus Christ is my Savior and Lord. Amen. Bless you. You may be seated. Not only is this a day of declaration, but this is also a day of identification. Because of this declarative statement that you have made, you are identifying yourself with the person and the life of Jesus Christ. You could say something like this: because I have confessed my sin, and because I've acknowledged Christ as my Savior and Lord, I choose to be forever identified as a Christian. Not as a religious person, but as a believer and a follower of Jesus Christ. Hopefully you will be willing to say, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Let me wrap up with this, and then we will send you out that door. And Linda Panos is at the end of that pew, and she will take you out and give you directions about changing clothes and bring you around to the appropriate door for us to share in baptism. Ivan the Great was the Tsar of all Russia during the 15th century. He was the one who was able to bring together all of the warring tribes into one vast empire that eventually became known as the Soviet Union. As a fighting man, he was exceedingly courageous. As a general, they tell me he was extremely brilliant. He drove out the Tartars and established peace across the nation. However, Ivan was so busy waging his campaigns that he did not have a family. His friends and his advisors were quite concerned. They reminded him that there was no heir to the throne, and should something happen to him, the union would shatter into chaos. "You must take a wife who can bear you a son," they said. The busy soldier statesman said to them he did not have the time to search for a bride, but if they could find a suitable one, he would marry her. The counselors and advisors searched the capitals of Europe to find an appropriate wife for the great Tsar, and they found her. They reported to Ivan about a beautiful, dark-eyed daughter of the king of Greece. She was young, she was brilliant, she was charming, and she was exquisitely beautiful. He agreed to marry her, sight unseen. The king of Greece was delighted, for it would align Greece, a small country, in a favorable way with the emerging giant of the north. But there was one condition that the king said the Tsar must meet. "He cannot marry my daughter unless he becomes a member of the Greek Orthodox Church." Ivan's response: "I will! I will!" A priest was dispatched to Moscow to instruct Ivan in Orthodox doctrine. He was a quick student, and he learned the catechisms in record time. Arrangements were concluded, and the Tsar made his way to Athens, accompanied by 500 of his crack troops, his personal palace guard. He was to be baptized into the Orthodox Church by immersion, just as we are going to share in today. That was the custom of the Eastern Church. His soldiers, ever loyal to the Tsar, asked if they could also be baptized. The patriarch of the church assigned 500 priests to give the soldiers a one-on-one catechism crash course. The soldiers, all 500 of them, completed the course and were prepared to be immersed in a mass baptism. When word got out, crowds from all over Greece assembled. What a sight that must have been! 500 priests and 500 soldiers walking into the blue Mediterranean Sea. The priests were dressed in their black robes and their tall black hats, the official dress of the Orthodox Church. The soldiers wore their battle uniforms with all the regalia, ribbons of valor, medals of courage, and their weapons of battle. Suddenly, there was a problem. The problem is the church prohibited professional soldiers from being members. These men would have to give up their commitment to bloodshed. They could not be soldiers and church members too. After a little hasty meeting and a round of diplomacy, the problem was solved quite simply. As the words were spoken and the priests began to baptize each soldier would reach to his side, withdraw his sword, lift it high over his head, and every soldier was immersed. Everything except his fighting arm and sword stayed above the water. That is a true historical fact. The unbaptized arm. And you're saying, "Tim, why are you telling this story?" Because I'm going to ask of you, is there any part of you that you're not going to let be baptized today? Is there any part of your life that you are going to hold back in reserve and say, "No, I want to maintain this"? You've heard me ask them the question. I'm going to ask you to let God ask you the question. Is there any part of your life today that would be symbolized as an unbaptized arm? What a powerful picture for us. I wonder how many of us here have some part of our life we've departmentalized away from God. How many unbaptized wills, the decision maker of our life, do we have here today? How many unbaptized talents? You sing, but you never sing for the Lord. You can teach, but you never teach the children. You've been gifted, and yet you reserve that for your own pleasure. How many unbaptized checking accounts and social activities? What part have you not surrendered? As you guys head out today, make sure you've surrendered it all. Because he sacrificed it all so we could have all of him. Let's pray. Father, thank you for these men and women, and these young men and young girls who are going to step into the baptistry today. They've made this a day of declaration. They've made this a day of identification. And Father, may we share in their celebration with them of what all this means. We commit this to you in the name of Christ. Amen and amen. I'm going to ask our participants if you would follow Linda out the door, and she will take you to where you can make your changes. The worship team is coming back to the platform to lead you in worship while we get dressed for baptism, or undressed, as the case may be. Stand right there for just a moment so I know they can see you real good, all right? This is Brody Fish, all right? If you are part of the fish family, would you stand up, all right? You're part of the fish family. Stand up, because there's lots of little fishes out there, all right? And Grandma's back here, all right? And it's great fun. You may be seated. Brody, you run with a pretty good school of fish, all right? And, you know, it is so much fun every Sunday for me to see you and your brothers and your sisters and everybody here. I enjoy it so very, very much. And you always make a point to come give me a fist or a high five. And I love that. So thank you for letting me have the privilege of sharing in this moment with you. Mm-hmm. Brody, have you invited Jesus Christ to come live within your life?
Yes.
And you know that you are a Christian?
Yes.
Amen. And who is your Sunday school teacher?
Pastor Bill,
and I think he came in just for that. He's right over there. All right. You got a promotion. That's good. That's good. Yeah. All right. That means 24/7 call now. All right, Brody, we're going to share in your baptism. Step right on down here with me. All right. Look right over there at Grandma. All right. Give her a big smile. All right. Oh, there we go. Take your hands just like this. Brody, because you have invited Jesus Christ to come live in your heart, and he is now your personal Savior and Lord, it is my happy privilege as your pastor to get to baptize you as my brother in Christ, and I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Marilyn, how long have you been hanging out at New Hope?
26 months.
26, a little over 2 years.
Yes.
I hope you don't take offense at what I'm going to tell them about you. If you do, you can baptize me, okay?
Okay.
When Marilyn first started coming to New Hope, she was a very sad and a very lonely and often very confused about making choices in her life. And we have seen her through her small group and her fellowship of friends and our Wednesday night Bible study and her acceptance of Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord in her life. We have watched her become a person who now has joy in her heart and a woman who now can make decisions that she couldn't make before. In fact, she's making one I don't like. She's moving to Oregon, all right? But that's a good thing. That is a God-directed thing. And 2 years ago, that's a decision she could have never made. And so because of the difference that Christ has made in her life, there is a transformation that for those of us who know Marilyn have seen it. So here's my question for you, Marilyn.
Yes.
Have you invited Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sin and come be the Lord of your life?
Yes, I have.
Perfect. It is our privilege to baptize you today then.
Thank you.
Thank you. Those of you who are part of either her family or small group, would you please stand? You're here with Marilyn and part of her small group or family. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here. All right. Just like this. Marilyn, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, it is my happy privilege to baptize you as my sister to God's family. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. If you are part of Amy's contingency here today, would you please stand? All right. I know she's got some family and friends who were there. Thank you so much for coming and sharing this moment with her. Amy, how long have you been hanging out around New Hope?
I've only been here for about 6 months.
About 6 months. I love it. Thank you for coming.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming. I love that smile. You may be seated, so you're not in the way of the video camera back there. All right. But Amy has this most vivacious smile that radiates all the way from wherever she's sitting right up to the stage. And so I'm happy that you're here. Amy, have you invited Jesus Christ to come live in your life and to be your personal Savior?
Yes, I have.
It is a privilege then to share in this moment with you today. You're not in elementary school. You're not in junior high. You're not in high school. What do you do?
I'm a stay-at-home mom right now.
Okay, perfect. How many kids do you have?
I have two little girls.
Two little girls, and they're back there?
Yes.
Wave at them. All right, wave at them. All right, they're waving back. Good. Turn and face. Right over there. Step forward. Good. Take your hand just like this. Perfect. Amy, because of your profession of faith, Jesus Christ is your Savior and Lord. What a wonderful example for your family and your children you're making today. It is my privilege and my pleasure to baptize you as my sister in faith. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Amy. Thank you. Okay, this next one, we're gonna, it may take us a moment to, it's a little challenging. We're gonna get three people into baptistry at once, okay? So this is Kelly Dunkel. Kelly, if you just take a stand on the step up there, and your husband is going to come join us. Okay. Careful. I know all the men never want to take my hand. All right. Jim, take my hand. All right. Trust me. All right.
I'm going to put us all three down.
I want you to stay right there on that step for a moment. All right. The reason the three of them are in here together, dang, he's really big when he stands on a step. The reason that all three of them are together is because there's a connection that goes back several decades. I have known Jim for probably over 20 years, all right? He was the electrician at our house. He was the electrician when we needed somebody here at church. Somebody gave me his name many moons ago. I knew he had been a Christian, but I knew that he had kind of put his faith on hold for a long period of time and would just nudge him every now and then. And about 2 years ago, God decided to nudge him a little bit more and get his attention. And so Jim has been baptized before, but this is a reflection today of this more recent commitment in his life. At about that same time, a young family started attending New Hope, and they were brand new. Ed Dunkel is precision engineering, not plastics, precision engineering. And he happened to be early on in their early months of attending here. He heard me grumble about the county of Fresno and our problem trying to get our pavilion passed and done. And so he sent a message through email one day and said, if I can help, let me know. I'll do my best. So I saw the county on a Tuesday. On a Wednesday, I was calling him. And on Thursday, we had an appointment at his office. And so then I go to his office and we show him the plans and explain the challenges with the county. And he said, are you going to do any electrical work in it? And I said, no, yes. Didn't I? Yeah. Yeah. I'm telling you the truth, all right? I said, no, not as far as the county knows, but yes, after the county's out of the picture. Pastors should be honest, right? And he said, well, who's doing your electrical work? And I said, well, a retired PG&E guy by the name of Jim Critchfield. And I mean, just like that, Ed's eyes started to water. And he said, did he used to do a bus ministry at another church in town? And I said, well, yeah, I believe he did. He said, he used to pick me up every Sunday morning when I was just a boy and not a great place in my life. And he would take me to church, and he made a difference in my life. And I got my cell phone out, and I dialed Jim's number, and I handed it to him. And Shelly and I sat there and listened to a one-sided conversation. And I don't know how much Jim was crying on the other end, but I can tell you, Ed may look like a tough guy, but he had tears streaming down his face as these two reconnected. And so when it was announced here a while back, we were going to have a baptism, and Ed said, I want to be baptized. Jim said, can I do it again? And I'd like to do it that same time. And so that's the reason I have all of them in the baptistry together here today. So, and you heard the news in the prayer. The cancer is under control. Everything has shrunk, and the medicine is doing its work, and the treatment has been good. And pounds have you put on?
I went from 165 to 210.
And his hair is back.
Jim?
Praise God.
I'm going to baptize the old guy first.
Good. I'll take care of it.
All right. All right. Anything you want to, Jim? I know you've got Christ in your heart.
Well, my friends stand up.
All right. You, oh, yes. Family and friends of Jim Critchfield, please stand up. Small group, family.
Put your toes up here, you put your toes on the band there. Put your hands up.
Father, what a privilege it is to stand here with my friend and my brother. I am so grateful for his love for you, and I'm so grateful for your patience with him. And I'm glad that he has returned as a prodigal to your family. Thank you for your undying love and your incredible patience. And thank you for the difference that he makes in the lives of others as he shares his faith. It is our joy today to share in this baptism with my brother. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That would have been easier if you had 165.
No.
I'm going to do you next, Ed. I know we're supposed to do ladies first, but we're kind of going in reverse order. I know that she is younger than you.
Yes.
So we went from the old guy to the young woman, okay?
Yes.
So, Ed, when did you come to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior?
I'd say 12.
Okay.
I was 12.
All right.
Earlier, really, because of Jim's efforts.
All right. And then for several years, you just kind of let your relationship with the Lord just kind of be on hold.
Yeah, try to do things my way.
Okay.
Done for a while.
And how did that work for you?
Not very good.
Okay. All right. Good. And it has been our joy and pleasure to have you and your beautiful children. Kids, wave your hands at Daddy. All right. There they are, right up here on the front row. All right. Terrific. Any other family and friends here with the stand up, please. Stand up back there in the back. All right. Yeah. Thank you. All right. Terrific. Ed, because of your profession of faith, dang, you're thicker than you look, you know, out there. It's a thick body, man. Ed, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior Lord, it is my happy privilege to baptize you as my brother in Jesus Christ. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Actually, Ed, you know what? I want you to do something. We're going to do something. I want you to get on the backside. You're going to help me baptize your wife. Are you okay? All right. Kelly, how long have you been married to this man?
4.5 years.
Okay. Terrific. Ed, how long has she been married to you?
I'm the one that's supposed to mess.
That's right. Good. Well, I put her on the spot. I told her I was only going to ask one question. Kelly, have you invited Jesus Christ to be your Savior and Lord?
Yes.
Terrific. Then it is our joy to share in this moment of your baptism with you as part of God's family. I'm going to ask you to face Jim right there. And I just want you to put a hand on her other shoulder over here, all right? When I lay her back, you just help me do that, all right? Take your hands just like this. Kelly, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, it is my joy and my delight to baptize you as my sister into his family. And I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Brooke, they're scary, aren't they? That's what I look at every Sunday. Brooke, where do you go to school?
Clovis North.
Outstanding. What year are you there?
Freshman.
You are a freshman, so you are going to take that campus by storm over the next 4 years, right?
Yep.
Good for you. I understand your older sister graduates this year and she's leaving you all alone. All right.
Yeah,
you can hardly wait, huh? That wasn't fair. Brooke, it's been a pleasure. I have watched you grow up from a little bitty girl around here, all right, coming with your mom and dad, all the way to the lovely young lady that you are. What I want to know, though, is have you invited Jesus Christ to come live in your life?
Yes.
He is your Savior and Lord.
Yes.
Do you remember where you were when you made that decision?
I think I was about 10 years old in my bedroom.
In your bedroom. Terrific. I'm glad you did that. And I'm happy to be able to share in this moment with you. Family and friends of Brooke, please stand up. All right? Right there on the front row. All right. All right. Brooke, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, it is my privilege, my joy, my delight, my excitement to share with you in this moment. I baptize you as my sister into God's family. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, if you're part of Dane's family and friends who are here today, would you please stand? If you're part of Dane's family and friends, please stand. Dane, I remember when Bethany started bringing you around. I thought, what does she see in him? Actually, that was not the case. I liked you the first time I met you. And you have that kind of pleasant personality that's easy to warm up to. And what I really like about you is, as far as I know, you have been really good to Bethany. And that's very important to me. And so I'm grateful that you've done that. And you're a wonderful dad. You're engaged with your family. And I say thanks for that. And I'm really happy to see you leading them back to church. So that's exciting. So it's fun to share in this moment with you. How long have you and Bethany been married now?
Almost 10 years.
10 years. I told him I thought it was 10 years at 8 o'clock service. So I haven't lost all of my mind yet. Yeah. So Dane, have you invited Jesus Christ to live in your life and you know him as your Savior and Lord?
Yes, I have.
And it's my privilege to share in this very special moment with you. As you face Linda over there, taking him just like this. Dang, I got all these thick-bodied guys today, man. Dear Father, it's a joy and a privilege to share in special moments in the lives of friends and family. And Dane is like both. And so it is a pleasure to share in this moment to baptize him into your family because he has professed your Son as his Savior. And so I baptize him in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The worship team is going to come back and they're going to close out our worship time. I don't know if you're doing one or two, but when you finish this one, just give a prayer of dismissal, all right? And everybody can bail out because we'll be doing this all over again in the next service. Thank you so very much for coming. It's been our pleasure to have you here for this very special day. If you do not have a church home or a church family, we would love for you to come back and visit us again. Know that we care deeply about what God wants to do in your life, and we'd love to be a part of helping you get there. Thank you so very much for coming. Enjoy the rest of your day.